Hey, welcome everyone. I hope you have a good day. And today we're going to talk about event-driven architectures. Does any of you here have already worked or are working actually with an event-driven architecture? Can you please raise your hands? That's great. That's the topic today. So we're going to have fun. So today we're going to be actually a barmaid or a barman. So yes, this is going to be you. And what we're actually going to try and build together is, yes, a cocktail. How we are going to actually do it? We are going to do it with your event-driven architecture. That's the fun part. And at the end of the day, this is what it will look like. This is going to be actually your business squad. And they're going to sip their cocktail slash mocktail directly through a straw. And in fact, they did not even know that those are the events that are flowing through your event-driven architecture. That's the magic besides that. So for a bit of context around myself, this is me. Great picture of myself. I'm Sebastian Napoleon. I'm a French speaking. I'm also a cloud and DevOps consultant at Ipen Technologies, which is a French company, but we're also based in the US. Around AWS, yes, I love AWS. I have some certifications. I also like Terraform. Please don't woo me. And also, I'm a bit interested in Kubernetes. I would like to stop about on this topic of the AWS Community Builder Program, because I am a proud member of this program, actually. This is something really great if you like to actually share content with others like I'm doing today. And I had actually this opportunity to be a speaker at reInvent thanks to this AWS Community Builder Program. So please, if you like to share content, try and come and join us. Also, oh, this is a bit of a spoil, but do we have any of you guys fan of sneakers or motorcycle? You can raise one hand or both if you're a fan of both. OK, great. I can see some hands here. So yep, I'm a big fan of sneakers here, and also a big fan of motorcycle. That's my baby, actually. So now that you know a bit more about myself, we're going to go through the agenda together. We're going to first start with a bit of context, because I have to do it. Then we'll dig a bit into the services overview that I've taken actually for my architecture. And then, obviously, we're going to conclude together. So let's dig a bit more about this context. This is what I like to call the gold mine. And I mean, I guess some of you have already seen those kind of events. I've just taken it from AWS Event Bridge. This is a JSON event. And this is really the goldmine. And this is going to be our ingredients tonight. So those are two fields that are really important in this event. You can find the detail type as well as the source. You can see here that there is actually one item that has been sold from the sales domain. That's great. We love that. But what's more interesting here, it's this detailed field that you see on the bottom. This one is actually fully customizable. And you can find a lot of interesting stuff here. As you can see here, we have sold one item from the sales domain. And this item is actually a toothbrush. This toothbrush cost us $9.99. And we only sold one. Yes, I'm a bad salesman, but I've tried. As I like to say, time is money. So are events in your event-driven architecture. This is actually a quote from myself, but I think this one is really important. So it's now time to dig a bit deeper into those kind of services that I've actually used. This is the architecture that I've put in place with actually CDK. So we are going to focus first, if you want, on those two services here, AWS Lambda and also Amazon Event Bridge. So if we go into the Jigger part here, it's actually an AWS service that is used to execute code without having to manage the infrastructure. That's nice. Everybody loves serverless, I guess. You don't need to have an EC2 instance for this kind of thing. We'll go with this one. that's actually better because you only pay for each code execution. That's nice. You don't pay for the whole server running 24/7. You don't need this, actually. And in our case, I like to call it the Jigger because we are actually building Cocktail and Mocktail because this is something that is producing events. And also, it serves as a data transformation thing you will see later. So now we can see that I'm also using Event Bridge. Yes, I'm talking actually about event-driven architecture. I have to talk about Event Bridge. And this is actually going to be the trainer. And how AWS Event Bridge actually works, it works with event bus and event rules. This is obviously the foundation of every event-driven architecture. Every time you will see event-driven architecture in AWS, it's either Event Bridge or maybe some of the times MSK. And here, we are going to use this Event Bridge service to actually receive events and also forward them directly to a Kinesis data firehose. That's great. Now we can actually focus on those two right here. We've got the Kinesis data firehose and also the data catalog, which comes from AWS Glue. Let's zoom a bit on those one. So let's start with Kinesis data firehose, which is going to be actually our shaker. It's an AWS fully managed ETL service. Actually, the E comes from extract, so you extract data from a source X, then you can transform it if you want, and then you're going to load this data to destination Y. I've talked about transformation of data. Something that's cool with Kinesis Data Firehose is you can actually transform the events that you get as an input, let's say this raw event bridge JSON thing, then you will actually want to convert it to something more business-oriented with a real schema behind. This is something that you can actually do with some really cool service like AWS Lambda. And then something also really important that I've learned, when you transform your data into CSV, you can also change the data format at the end. You don't want to store this data as plain JSON. You can actually change it to become Parquet. And then what's more magical to be able to, with just a cross, to actually compress the data. That's something that can be done with Kinesis Data Firehose. And that will actually help you save money. Now, as you can see, the name on my slide is Data Catalog. But this one comes from AWS Glue. And this is what I like to call the straw guide. You will see what I call this the guide for the straw just after. But let's focus on this one. Actually, Glue Data Catalog is a service that stores table metadata for the S3 data in our case. It really serves here as a data schema reference in our case for the data that are going to be stored in this S3 bucket. And every time we're going to query things in this S3 bucket. And yes, I'm going to query into S3, so I'm going to use AWS Athena. And this will be thanks to this data catalog table that Athena will know which type of query will be possible into this S3 bucket. That's great. We've now halfway done. And let's focus on those two here. So Amazon S3 and also AWS Athena, which is where actually the magic happens. So Athena, this is the straw in our cocktail/mocktail. Now you got the reference for the straw guide. Athena is actually used here to query data from multiple data stores with, and that's important, with SQL language. That's what a lot of developers want. They want to use actually SQL language. It's way easier. And yes, you can query data from multiple data stores with Athena, but most of the times, people are going to use Athena with S3. And this is actually our case. Something nice to know also is it's using actually Apache Spark underneath. And be careful on this one. I had to put it on the slide, but the pricing model on AWS Athena is based on the terabyte of data that are actually scanned by a single query. So you have to think about which type of query are you going to make with Athena. Otherwise, it will actually cost you money. Now we've pretty much got everything for a good cocktail or mocktail, except that we don't want to put this cocktail mocktail on the floor. So we will need to have a glass. And this glass is actually going to be Amazon S3. I'm not sure I really need to introduce you to this AWS service, but let's go about. This is an object storage, which is actually highly scalable. It can store petabytes of data. And this is going to be actually the data store for our events. This is where we are going to put our events at the end and have something query on. And this something is actually the place where AWS Athena will query on our objects. And with the combination here of everything, the thing that's nice is that we can now shake everything. Whenever we shake everything, we have a result. And this result here is this slide that I've started my talk with. This is the business squad. And the business squad is now really happy because they have a straw to actually sip their cocktail slash mocktail. This straw is, yes, Athena. And they don't know that they are actually drinking a cocktail made of events that are flowing through your event-driven architecture. That's the magic here. And they can now start building actually dashboards. You can put AWS QuickSight, something like that, to build dashboard with this kind of architecture. That's something that's really nice. So as a conclusion here, I would like to say that it's nearly magical. And I like the nearly in my phrase, in my sentence. So the first services interaction can be a bit touchy. I'm not going to lie. The first time that you're going to actually deploy a Kinesis data firewall can be a bit tricky. It has for me as well. I've talked about infrastructure as code at the beginning of my talk. I didn't at the time to go deeper inside, but I've used AWS CDK to deploy this kind of thing. And that's really magical. Like, I really like CDK. I've used TypeScript to do this. And really, it made everything so great. I'm an AWS community builder on the serverless field, so I had to talk about serverless. And serverless makes it really magic. That's actually the secret ingredient in everything in here that makes everything great and also cheap. Yes, this stack is really cheap at first. Be careful at first. I've actually deployed these kind of things on an architecture that stored around 100,000 events per day. It cost me $2 per month. That's nothing. Be careful if you store petabytes of data. It can actually skyrocket pretty rapidly if you don't have the best practices on AWS Athena and how to use a data partition in your S3 bucket with Kinesis Data Firewall. So be careful on this one, as it can really skyrocket rapidly. And there is also questions that can really arise for kind of bigger stack and bigger architecture. Sometimes when you really want to do analytical at scale, you may think of Amazon Redshift. And this is actually a question that you have to ask you at the beginning when you're actually building this architecture. Do I want to go with this kind of stack, or do I want to go directly with Amazon Redshift? Because when you're in the middle of the building of your architecture, this is not the moment where you want to actually ask those kind of questions. But the thing that's actually great with the architecture that I've just demonstrated to you here is that you can basically unplug the S3 as the output of the stack, and you can actually put the Amazon Redshift directly to the Kinesis Data Firehose. But you will need to migrate the data that was on S3 before to the Redshift. So it's something possible, but please ask you the good questions before going on those kind of things. And now, something that's also great, if you want to actually go further into the optimization, I've talked about a lot of things here, but there are a lot of things that can be actually optimized. The Athena query performance, that's something really important. If you want to have fast query, you have to know that Athena is actually based on the number of objects that are inside your S3 bucket. The more objects you have on your S3 bucket, the slower the query will be. So be careful on that one. I had some tricks with this. You can actually have EMR jobs that actually will take all of your objects at the end of the day that you put into your S3 bucket. You can group them together and have bigger chunk of objects. So you reduce the number of objects into your S3 bucket, then put it back into S3. And then the next time you're going to actually query this data, it will be way, way faster. So this is one of the free optimization. Now let's talk a bit about FinOps. Here in Athena, when you configure Athena for the first time, actually, you will need to configure an S3 bucket as a destination of the results of your query. Be careful if you actually do it with the console here, because you won't have lifecycle policies into this S3 bucket. And God knows that actually Athena queries can have output of like gigabyte of data into this S3 bucket. So if you don't have lifecycle policies here, the results will stay in this bucket forever, and you will pay for those results forever, even if you don't use them. So be careful on this one and think about lifecycle policies. And lastly, I want you to think about like the question for Redshift at the beginning of building this kind of architecture. Think about the schema that you're actually storing into this S3 bucket. You maybe don't need to actually store everything into this S3 bucket. You want to reduce the scope of the things that you're actually going to store, because you don't want to have a 10 kilobyte object in your S3 bucket if you're only querying on like half of it or maybe a quarter of it. So be careful on this one. It's OK for small architecture, like 100,000 events per day. It's nothing. If you go at scale with millions, tens of millions, thousands of millions, be careful on this one. It will actually cost you a lot of money, because S3 can grow rapidly. And that's basically it. If you're interested, my company, Ipon Technologies, have an ebook on AWS migration. I can let you 10 or 15 seconds here to grab the link and download it for free. And yep, I would really like to thank you all. That was my first time as a speaker in person. That's really great. I really liked it.